I'd like to walk through the Insight 100 pre-op ICL sizing and the tools that we have within the instrument to place calipers and take measurements once the images are captured. Here we have a patient that we've already grabbed an image of. You would select your patient name, come up here, double click on one of the scans, right or left eye, whichever you'd wish to go first. On the left-hand side of the screen are the various images that were taken during the scanning. The meridians are clearly identified here as they are on the right side of the machine here. So here we are, the 350-degree meridian. This is the right eye of the patient. The symbol up here tells us which is the temporal versus nasal side of the eye. In this case, temporal is on the left-hand side of the image. Now what I'm looking for is making sure that I've adjusted with the right mouse button, holding it down, I can brighten, I can change contrast, and what I'm trying to do is highlight the various structures within the eye so that I can clearly see them to take measurements. It is clear in this image that the temporal side, I am not able to see the ciliary body, so that would be a measurement that I would not take on this particular patient. We have multiple screens. We want to capture at least three of the meridians and take measurements on all three of those. So I'm going to just simply move beyond and just look at the other images here and see. Here we can clearly see all the structures necessary to take the measurements for the ICL sizing. Here's the order in which the measurements are taken. You can see here in this column, 354, 354. I hit the start button. Highlighted is the first cell here, that is for anterior chamber depth. Clicking the back side of the cornea, the anterior surface of the natural lens, it automatically populated that measurement in millimeters. Anterior chamber angle nasal, again, this is temporal on this side, so we start here. Scleral spur, here. Go to temporal, scleral spur, here, here. Next measurement is angle to angle. This is the angle recess. So it's the farthest recess within the iridocorneal angle. Here, here. Next one is anterior chamber width. That is defined by scleral spur to scleral spur. Angle recess to angle recess lens rise. From here to the front edge of the natural lens. The next one is the sulcus to sulcus. This is defined by the pigmentation on the posterior side of the iris, here, here. Sulcus to sulcus lens rise. Again here, up to there. Ciliary body inner diameter. These are the ciliary processes here. They're like little fingers. So you want to take the innermost region of that image. And here, we have all of those. We can go to the next one. And we'll follow the same thing. Start. Here, here. Taking the angles. Angle to angle, the recess to the recess. Then we can always look over here to see which is the next step. Anterior chamber width, again, scleral spur to scleral spur. Here's the recess lens rise. Sulcus to sulcus, again, the pigmentation to the pigmentation. The lens rise again from the sulcus to sulcus line. Ciliary body, inner diameter here. To here. Once I've gone through each of these and filled out the entire list, if I choose to make a change, maybe I don't feel, I can move the cursor. Once it turns to an X, I can grab that and move it to where it needs to be to edit that. Once I let go, it has changed that value in the table below. The wheel in the middle, you can zoom in. So if I wanted to touch these and move them just ever so slightly, again, we made a change. Zoom back out. Everything is calculated there. We're good to go for the next. Moving to the next. Again, we're following this. here to here, here, here. We've attempted with the rapid caliper tool to try to speed this process up as quick as possible. Every one of these measurements taken here are all averaged on the right-hand side as you enter them. It could be that a particular measurement that you really can't see that too well, and you may decide just to skip that measurement, and I'll show you that in just a moment here. So here are angle chamber width. Now, angle recess to angle recess, lens rise. Sulcus to sulcus. Let's say that this was a little bit dim over here. We couldn't quite see it well enough. Well, you can zoom in. I can hold the mouse wheel down and I can rotate back and forth. The right mouse, I can change contrast, brightness, etc. It's not really clearly defined to me where that actually ends. Okay. Obviously, with the ciliary process extruding this way, zonules coming out of it there, this could be another ciliary process here. Here's another one in the background, if you will. So we're not quite clear where that sulcus is. So I am going to use the skip button and skip over that for this particular. Because I skip that, I'm going to skip the sulcus to sulcus lens rise. Skip that one. Zooming back out. Now I want to do ciliary body, inner diameter. Here, here. So you can see it skipped those in that, but we've already got a few. That's why we want you to take a few of the various meridians that have the best imagery, and that way you have an average of them. Once you have gone through those and you feel that you have enough of your measurements taken, right here is the save button. Clicking on the save button, you have a couple options. You can save this image set as a PDF. Prior to saving it as a PDF, make sure you choose which one of these you feel is the best image to be present on that PDF. It could be this one. So when I hit save and save as a PDF, it is going to save that on this computer as a report with that picture and with all of the measurements that you have down in the table below. Another option here, you can save it as a JPEG. Perhaps you want to export this into your PAC system. Down here, the third option is export to a CSV. That's an Excel spreadsheet file. So here you could print on another computer your Excel spreadsheet. And from there, you would simply go to iclsizing.com. That's London Vision Clinic's website. It's not associated with ArcScan. It's a free to everybody website. You would enter in all of these values on that website. When doing that, the report that that site will give you will be either the Kojima, the Doherty, or the Nakamura, their callouts of the exact lens size that you need for your patient. What's wonderful about the site is for the London Vision Clinic, they're going to give you the four sizes of the ICL from STAR by length that will give you the predicted vault of what that would be. So if I were to go over here and look at a patient to show you what that vault would look like, here is a post-op image of an ICL in the eye and the measurements that we can take for that particular patient. Again, we've taken multiple meridians. The multiple meridians are so that we can visualize where the footplate of the lens is. So as I look through the various images here, you can clearly see that the footplate, here's the footplate here on the ciliary body, here's the footplate over here on the ciliary body, posterior of the ICL, anterior surface of the ICL. We're taking measurements of the depth here. This is central vault. And more importantly, especially in the high myope patients, we want to have a mid-periphery vault. So that is back here behind the iris. OCTs are not going to be able to get back here to see that. It's very critical because of the proximity of the lens. Here you have the angles, so you can compare pre-op angles to post-op angles. As long as you're, what we're hearing, above 15 degrees on those angles, your patient's good to go. So with that, that is pre-op measurements, and here's a post-op image to validate just what your vaults are and how that lens is sitting in the eye, and you can look at multiple meridians to make sure that the foot plates are not resting on assist, and if you needed to make an adjustment to the lens, you could simply come back in through your incision, readjust the foot plates, and now your vault and your lens is sitting correctly as you had planned. With that is the ICL pre-op and post-op measurements on the Insight 100.